gather a pulp clear. That is water clear glass. It's just orange because it's at 2100 degrees and it's glowing. And at that temperature, Tim's showing you here, it's about the consistency of honey as it comes out of the furnace. And it's going to go through progressive stages of firmness as it approaches its freezing temperature, which is a frosty 950 degrees Fahrenheit, at which point that glass will be just as firm and fragile as room temperature glass. Now you're going to see Tim shape this into a cylindrical form on our steel table. The steel table is known as a marver, which is from the Italian for marble. Back when the Italians first started gluing glass, they didn't have the luxury of a nice steel table like this. They had a real nice 3-inch thick slab of marble that they used in the same way for the same purposes of shaping and through contact cooling the glass, which is what Tim wants right now. He wants this glass to approach that freezing temperature so that he's provided with a firm foundation upon which he can get his next accumulation of molten clear out of the furnace. Building in layers until he has the appropriate amount of molten glass for the piece he has in mind. He can't just go in and gather up, say, all 5 pounds of glass that he may want for a particular piece. Each time we gather, there's a terminal amount of material that will adhere either to the blowpipe or to the previous gathers. So we'll build in layers until we have the desired amount of material. You can see that as he stops rotating the pipe, there's very little movement to the glass, indicating it has approached that freezing temperature. Then he can use that solid foundation to get this next accumulation, or what we call a gather. Coming out now, he's going to use the molten quality of that second gather to begin introducing some color, which in this case is in the form of frit. These very uniform sized chips of very densely colored glass, made from the same recipe of glass as the clear glass that we're melting in the main furnace, but it's had the introduction of a metal or a metal oxide. Tim's using a purple and a white here. That purple is created by the introduction of magnesium, and the white is created by the introduction of titanium. Now once he goes all the way around the body of the piece, because that frit is at room temperature, he's got to liquefy that frit. So he does that with a trip to our reheating unit, which is traditionally referred to as a glory hole, and is attaining temperatures of about 2500 degrees Fahrenheit. And you'll see that it takes just a few short moments inside that intense environment of the glory hole to transform that frit into a liquefied state. This will allow Tim to come back and get a second layer of those colors, which will build up the density of color, which is exactly what he needs, because as he begins to introduce air into the blowpipe, creating a bubble, that color is going to stretch with the bubble. And as it stretches, it will thin. So in order to achieve the intended density of color in his finished piece, he's going to get a couple really good dense coatings at this point. Now Tim wants to manipulate the color into somewhat of a pattern. If he were to leave it just the way it is and began to create a bubble, blowing that out, it would represent as a series of dots of color. He wants to put a little bit of a pattern into the glass. I'm going to clear off the surface of this steel table so it's got a good clean work area. We don't want any unwanted additions at this point. So he's going to take the glass to the glory hole and get it good and soft. He'll make his way back over to the marver, where he's going to initially attain a cylindrical form. The glass got kind of squared up from the color application. He'll get it rounded out, and then he'll touch the nose of that cylinder to the table. And now watch as he rotates the pipe a little faster than he allows the glass to roll down the surface of the table, as he gets that purple and white glass to spiral around the body of the vessel. Now every moment of contact of the glass to that steel table is wicking temperature out of the glass, causing it to become progressively firmer. He wants to get a little more twist to that pattern. So So to do that, he'll restore the temperature there at the glory hole, and then he'll make his way here to the gaffer's bench, where he's going to use this tool called the diamond shear. He'll use that to grab a hold of the nose of that cylinder, impart some more resistance, and get further spiraling for that pattern. He'll get that glass good and hot again. You can see by that orange glow, he's got a good heat. He'll grab the nose, give that a little more twist and really tighten that spiral down. He's now gonna use his glass blowing tweezers to create these swirls in the color that is spiraled around the body of the piece. Each time he plunges those tweezers into the glass to create one of these swirls, he's also creating an indentation in the surface of the glass. We're going to put another gather of molten clear over this, but before we do, we must eliminate those indentations, because anywhere there's an impression in the surface, when we go back in for another gather of molten clear, those indentations would each capture an air bubble. So to eliminate that possibility, he's going to smooth the surface back out by doing what we call a fire polish, taking the glass right in front of the burner head. He's going to bring that temperature back up around 2,000 degrees. Now as the glass heats, it's going to soften it, and it will begin to naturally heal any kind of impression that's in the surface of the glass. The nature of the glass is it wants to be free of any texture or any character whatsoever. So as it heats, it will begin to naturally smooth out by itself. Any remaining texture he'll eliminate by passing across the surface of the marble once again, creating a nice smooth surface that will provide him with a bubble-free gather when he goes into this next layer of molten clear. So you can see there how that texture is highly diminished, and then rolling across the marble, get that nice smooth surface that it needs. He's also going to alter the taper of the glass onto the blowpipe by lowering the handle of the blowpipe and contacting the glass there, getting that nice taper transition. And with that, Tim is ready now to begin introducing some air into the blowpipe to create his initial bubble. He's going to restore the temperature and then make his way here to the bench, where he's going to shape the glass into a nice, even, symmetric form using this tool called a block. This is made out of waterlogged black cherry wood, and as the molten glass contacts the moisture in that tool, it will convert that moisture to steam. That thin vapor of steam will then act to separate the glass from actually touching the wood, while allowing the wood to shape the glass is separated by that thin vapor. Once he has the glass into a nice, even symmetry, you'll see Tim pressurize the blowpipe with a puff of air, capturing that puff of air with his thumb over the opening of the end of the blowpipe. Then as the air in the blowpipe is heated by its contact with the molten glass, it will cause that air to expand. Since he'll have his thumb over the opening, that expanding air will have nowhere to go but the path of least resistance, which will be into that hot, soft glass, creating that initial bubble. Now he can't actually observe the bubble itself as it emerges out of the end of the pipe because of that dense color, but what Tim can detect are subtle changes to the exterior contour that would indicate that that bubble had formed on the interior, forcing that exterior contour to alter. He's going to go ahead and get this back into a nice even symmetry using the appropriate size wooden block to allow the glass on the pipe to approach that freezing temperature once again in preparation for his next full gather of molten clear out of the main furnace, particularly now that he has a bubble established. We want to make sure that we're down around that freezing temperature, because if Tim tries to apply more molten glass on top of this while it's still too hot, the heat from the fresh gather will then cause this glass to become molten again too quickly, and that can cause that bubble to collapse, or it can strip color off into our main furnace, which contains only clear. So he'll watch the color of the glass, the movement of the glass, and the color of the tip of the blowpipe, and those are the things that will indicate to him when this has approached that freezing temperature, he can safely get that next gather. Now as he allows this to cool, he'll let you get a look at that pattern that he's established.
Yeah,
do resist the urge to reach out and touch the pretty
glass. That is lovely.
to leave you with a second degree souvenir.
Beautiful.
One that you probably don't want to take home.
This makes me think of Van Gogh's Starry Night pattern.
Right now, and as we get our next gathering, Tim begins to impart air to the blowpipe, increases the bubble in size. That pattern will increase proportionately with the bubble. Besides the visual cues that Tim uses to determine the temperature of the glass, we actually have an auditory cue where we can hear when the glass approaches that freezing temperature. If you guys listen real closely, I think you can probably hear it as well. It's a very distinct sound, and it's just like that. That glass is nice and firm. And then you can go ahead and plunge that back down into the mouth and get this next gather. This is going to give Tim the amount of material that he needs for this piece. It's also going to act to magnify that color pattern. Coming out, he wants to chill the shaft with the blowpipe. It gets heated up from resting on the 2,000-degree sill of the furnace as it gets its gather. The glass itself is only heating that blowpipe up about 14 inches up the pipe from the glass, where you see that discolored portion of the blowpipe. That discolored portion of the blowpipe is what we as glassblowers refer to as the no-touch zone. And as glassblowers, yes, we all do make incidental contact with that portion of the blowpipe, which just goes to further reinforce the fact that that is indeed the no-touch zone. And trust me, there's a very short learning curve on that one. Now you're going to see Tim accomplish one of two essential elements in any piece of blown glass, that being the even distribution of the material on the end of the blowpipe. Once he's accomplished that, he'll be off to the glory hole to accomplish the second essential element, which is an even heat throughout evenly distributed material. This will ensure that as he begins to increase the bubble in size, it will move evenly through that evenly distributed and heated material, providing him with a consistent wall thickness in his finished piece. Now, as hard as Tim tries to get all of the glass on the blowpipe to the exact same temperature, as he exits that glory hole, the nose of that bubble is going to be just a little bit hotter than the glass up by the blowpipe. There's a couple reasons for that. One is that where the nose of that bubble is right now is hotter at the back of the glory hole than it is up by the door, and the glass that's in direct contact with the steel of the blowpipe is having the temperature wicked out of it by its contact with that steel. So to compensate for that temperature difference, Tim's going to chill that hottest portion by passing it across the surface of the marver, not only shaping it, but setting up somewhat of a thickness and a chilled skin on that portion of the glass, so that as he does begin to introduce air, you'll notice the expansion now occurring closer to the blowpipe and the equator of that bubble, maintaining a thickness there off the nose. We've got to work these bubbles from the blowpipe out because that glass is cooling the thickest up there by the blowpipe. So by chilling that lower portion, he's able to achieve the expansion that he needs up by the blowpipe. If we allow that bubble to push down into that thick glass off the nose before we get the glass up by the pipe blown out, we're presented with a series of challenges in getting that glass up by the blowpipe hot enough to move without overheating the nose portion of that bubble. Once he's attained the expansion he wants, it's back to the glory hole. We've outgrown the opening on this door, so we'll pop that open to reveal our larger opening. We don't want to take a chance of punching the glass to the refractory, as they're both hot, they will adhere to each other. That could cause for a disastrous outing. He's going to restore the temperature. He's then going to make his way back over to the gaffer's bench, where he's going to use his tool called the scissor jacks to begin creating a compression just off the end of the blowpipe. That's where this piece will eventually be removed from the blowpipe, and this will become the lip of Tim's vessel. A good sharp compression equates to a good clean even break. I'm just shielding his hand and forearm from the radiant heat here, extending his working time. He's going to get an expansion here. You can see that due to that even distribution of both heat and material, how he's created almost a perfect sphere shape. He's asked me to create an addition for him now in the form of a